Well, I don't know about you, but I was taught that there are two things that you do not talk about in public or polite conversation. Were you taught this as well? What are those two things? Politics and religion. When it comes to those, keep it to yourself because you don't know where people stand. You might offend people. You might put them off. You don't know what they've been through, what they think, all that kind of thing. And I totally get that, but what about when the conversation moves past the polite public conversation? I think this keep it to yourself thing runs a little bit deeper than maybe it should. Now, I get it with our culture. One of the things that we get to enjoy here is our freedom in the United States, this spirit of independence and the freedom that we have to gather in a place like this or log on and watch this and speak freely about our faith and what's going on with one another. But culturally, it's kind of this separation of church and state, work and private, that we kind of take all of this and we cordon it off, and that anything that has to do with this most pivotal part of our lives, we're just kind of expected to keep it to ourselves. I kind of understand where that comes from. Where I get a little confused maybe is even when we step into groups of believers. Now, you may be here and you're not really a follower of Jesus. You kind of checking this thing out. You're not sure where you land on this, but you care about the person who brought you, and so you're doing that thing, and that's awesome. That's amazing. That's cool. There's space for you here. You're welcome. Keep looking at Jesus. He's awesome. He always measures up. But for some of us who've been believers for a while, sometimes we keep it to ourselves, even when we really shouldn't. We kind of guard and we're afraid of what people might find out, or we're afraid that if we speak up about Jesus with people who we're not sure where they stand, that somehow we might offend them and drive them off, and that's the last thing that we want. I'm afraid this thing has gone just a little too deep, because when I look at Jesus, when I look at what he has said in the scriptures, there's really nothing about Jesus that says keep it to yourself. This idea of our faith being private is a little bit crazy. And so for the next little while, we're going to talk about two things. We're going to say one thing two ways, and here it is. The first one is this: don't keep it to yourself. We're going to talk about it in two venues. Don't keep it to yourself. I know culture says keep it to yourself, but don't. Jesus didn't say anything like that. Now, I want to acknowledge right out of the gate that following Jesus really is very personal. You know why? Because Jesus is a person. He's not a list. He's not a book. He's personal. And when we allow Jesus to start to speak into our lives, some of the best of what Jesus does in our lives is on the deep stuff in our lives, the things that matter the most to us, who we are, the decisions that we make, the way we treat people. All those things are deeply personal. But that's not the same as private. Even though Jesus works on the most integral personal parts of us, he never says, keep it private, do this by yourself, be in isolation. In fact, when he spoke us into existence, he created us out of community and for community. And we're going to talk about this. We're going to look at Jesus' life. And so here's the thing. I think the first way we should probably look at this is to not keep it to ourselves with other Jesus followers. Now, again, you may not put yourself in that camp yet. Maybe you're just around and you're checking stuff out. That's awesome. But just use this as a little window into why we are so adamant about spending time together, about why we care so much about community, about why we work so hard to get along with each other, even though sometimes we drive each other crazy, all right? As I get that sometimes we try to keep it to ourselves within the church, but Jesus says don't. We do this for, I think, at least three reasons. Number one, I think that we have this awesome spirit of independence. It's one of my favorite things about our country and our culture. We try hard, we work hard, we pull ourselves up by our bootstraps, we provide for ourselves, we take responsibility. All those things are great. But that goes way too far when we run that into our faith. That Jesus never said, get it together on your own. He never said you should have been able to figure that out. He always says, I'll come with you and I'll surround people around you. And so those of us who are trying to tough it out and do it by ourselves and don't want to bother people, I don't think we're really that closely in line with what Jesus said. Even though there's great things about independence, there's greater things about interdependence. Another reason people try to keep it to themselves, their faith is never really honestly shared with other people, is they're afraid. What will they think of us if they find out? If they only knew that, what would they do? Would they judge me? Would they exclude me? How would all of that land? We get afraid and we start managing people's expectations of us and managing the impression that we make. Rather than being honest about where we are, we're a little bit afraid. Or there's this other group who I really have a lot of respect for. I grew up in a church, a smaller church, a church of about 300 people, and there were a lot of older people in our church who had years and years and years of following Jesus and had so much wisdom. But in their humility, they never really talked about their faith. They didn't want to feel like they were bragging. they kept it to themselves, which is admirable. But at the same time, there were so many things that they had learned that they could have passed on to my generation that I feel like we missed out on because we didn't get to see behind the veil. We didn't get to see behind the curtain of when they were in their desperate moments and called people to their side, or the things that they had questions or doubts about. We never really got to see that. And so here's what I was doing as we were thinking about this, that Jesus has never given me the impression that he's a keep it to himself Jesus. But I just thought, you know, let's just go to the source. Let's just read through his life. And so what I did is I kind of scanned through the book of Luke, a story of Jesus' life, one of the gospels, the good news about Jesus, and just said, what is he like? And I would encourage you to do that. If you like to read and you like details, go with Luke. It's the longest. If you're super spiritual, go John. If you like the short read, go with Mark. But choose one and jump in, okay? And just look and see what Jesus did with community. Now, if you're a blank filler in, you're going to love this next little section, because in the next 2 minutes, we're going to do more blanks than maybe we've ever done in 2 minutes. So grab your pencil and be ready to keep up, okay? I'm going to give you just a quick glance of some of what I found this week as I looked through Luke, because I think if you'll read one of the Gospels, you'll find exactly what I found, and that is that everything about Jesus points to community. And not to isolation, not to keeping it to ourselves. First and foremost, when the God of the universe decided to show up in his creation, to come in a way that we could understand and relate to, he did not come by himself. He showed up in a family. Right out of the gate, he joins a community. And then even when he's 12 or 13 years old and he's teaching in the temple, saying very important things about the kingdom of God and what he was going to do with his life, his family says, it's time to go home. And you know what Jesus said? Okay. In fact, Hebrews chapter 4 says that he learned obedience as he grew, that he was part of a community for all of his life. Once he started his ministry, he didn't do it by himself. He relied on supporters. If you look in Luke chapter 8, you find this amazing group of women whose lives had been changed by Jesus, and they provided support not only for Jesus to provide for him so he didn't have to work for his living, but also for his followers, the apostles, these 12 guys that Jesus had gathered around him. He relied on other people. Everything about Jesus points to community. And then there's this group of people that he mentored, this group of guys. He spends a whole night in prayer, stays up all night talking to his Father God about who are the guys. And he grabs the most ragtag bunch of knuckleheads, 12 guys. Like if you read the story, they screw up everything in every way possible, which is so good because I can relate. And it screws stuff up, but he mentors them. And every pivotal story in Jesus' life and ministry for the last 3.5 years of his life, these guys are invited, either the 12 or the 3. The most desperate moment of his life when he's praying the night before he's about to go give his life for all of us, he says, come with me. He invites these guys along with him. When he sends them out to tell people about him and do the things he's been doing, he didn't send them out alone. He sent them out in pairs. It was all about community. He says, you two go here, you two go here. With the first with the 12 and then with a larger group of 72. He sent them out together. Everything about Jesus points to community. He coached them toward community. He said, you know what? If you're ever coming to worship me, if you're going to bring an offering and remind yourself about our relationship and bring worship to me, here's what I want you to do. As you're bringing your offering, if you realize that you have a beef with somebody, put the offering down and slowly back away. Go fix it with that person and then come back and bring your offering. He was so serious about community. He said this too. He said, if you've got an issue with somebody, somebody sinned against you, you know what you should do? Put it on Facebook and tell everybody. That's not what he said. He said, go to them. And then he said, that's not enough. If they don't get it, grab somebody else who cares about them and go to them and do everything you can to help them get it. And if you still don't get it, go get the leaders of the church and come back a third time so they can get it and come back into community. He coached it all the time. In his last night, when he was praying to his Father God, John 17, the high priestly prayer, he prayed for one thing for all believers, pray for all of us this. He says, not only for me, not only for my disciples, but for everyone who will believe in my name, he prayed for one thing. He prayed for unity. He prayed that we would come together in such a way that the whole world would know that Jesus is legit, that they would see he is the one. You got one thing to pray for on the night before you're going to give your life, and that's what he chose. Everything about Jesus points to community. And then after he dies for our sins and resurrects to a new kind of life, never to end, inviting us into that kind of life, he says, I'm going to give you my presence in your life. The Holy Spirit, God himself, is going to move into your life to make you more like Jesus and to give you spiritual gifts, which sounds weird, except it just means this, that God's strength works in each one of us who believe in him in particular ways to help the church, the people of God, people trying to figure out who Jesus and everybody else in particular ways. And so God gave me a set of gifts, and God gave you a set of gifts, and someone else a set of gifts. And he spread those all around just as he saw fit. 1 Corinthians 12 says this. So that we would need each other. So that we would build one another up. So that we would be stronger together. Everything about Jesus points to community. You cannot take an honest look at Jesus or any story of his life and draw the conclusion that it's just between you and Jesus. It can't be done. There's no way you could look at his life and honestly come to the conclusion that you should follow Jesus all by yourself and not let anyone in. It can't be done. Now, I know people like this, and you may know people like this who say, you know what, I love Jesus, but I hate the church. Or you know what, I follow Jesus on my own, but church just really isn't a priority for me. Like, getting together with other believers doesn't really matter to me. And I'm like, I get it. Like, I have grace for that. I understand because, listen, I'm part of a church. I'm a church person, and I know church people. And can I just get an amen when I say that church people do dumb stuff sometimes? Anybody? Because I'm a church person who's done dumb stuff. I get it. Like, we mess stuff up. Eugene Peterson said this. There's nobody who doesn't have problems with the church because there's sin in the church. But there's nowhere else to be a Christian. In fact, I was sitting at Starbucks one time with one guy who had kind of been hurt by the church when he was younger. And we were talking about faith. He's like, yeah, I totally believe in God. And, you know, I kind of do that thing a little bit, but I don't do the church thing. I was like, oh, okay, that's cool, man. He goes, what do you do? I was like, okay, I'm a pastor at that big one over there on the corner. And it's easy to throw stones at big churches, and I get it. That's okay. I can deal with that. And so he says, how do you do that? I said, well, here's the thing, man. Every church is messed up, every single one, because people are messed up. And so if I got frustrated and I walked out like tomorrow and said, I'm never going back to that church, it's messed up, then probably what I would do is I start to follow Jesus is I would not be able to do that by myself, and so I would have somebody follow Jesus with me. And then inevitably we meet some other people who will follow Jesus, and then two would become four. And then four would become eight. Eight would become 16, and we'd have a small group, all right? And then those 16 or whatever, we follow Jesus, some move away, some would join, all of a sudden we'd be 30, now we don't fit in a living room, we got to get a building, we're on a corner, we got a website, we're a church. We're going to be right back where we started. You just can't do this thing on your own. In fact, for those people who would say that I just follow Jesus on my own, I'm like, I don't think you can. Because Jesus said his love language is obedience. The way we show him is by doing what he says. And so I would look at that person who follows Jesus by themselves, and I would say, how do you love each other? Like, do the math. Are you going to pull the mirror out? What's the plan? How do you serve each other? How do you love your enemy if you're never around them? Like, what does that even look like? It doesn't work. It's ridiculous to think that we could do this thing by ourselves. Jesus is not a keep it to himself Jesus. In fact, it's in Christian community that we become like Jesus. It's where we become like Jesus. It's where we speak the truth together to one another. It's why we sing out the truth. It's why we speak the truth from the scriptures each week. And it's why we look into the scriptures together in groups. We look at the Bible and see what Jesus is like and try to be like him. It's why we put up with each other. It's where we come alive. It's where we get better. So here's three questions if you want to lean into Christian community. Like, if you really want to follow Jesus' model and point everything in your life toward community, here's three questions I think it would be worth considering with you and God. Number one, this is a question you ask yourself. Who knows the person I want to become and sees enough of me to know that it's happening? Who gets a close enough view at your life who can say, hey, you say you want to be this, but I can see that you're being like this. You know what I'm saying? Now, for those of us who are Christians, the person I want to become is Jesus. So anything that's different, I give people permission to point that out. But even if you're not a Christian, you could apply this question to your community. Who sees what you have envisioned for yourself and then sees enough of you to show you when it's different? I went on this camping trip with a couple of buddies of mine. So we load up in a car. We drive 7 hours to Yosemite Valley. And then we walk 6 miles up to Little Yosemite Campground, and we set up tent, and then three of us sleep in a tent that's too small. And then we hike up in the dark because we wanted to see the sunrise from the top of Half Dome, and so we do another 4.5 or 5 miles or whatever it is up to the top of Half Dome. We watch the sunrise, we freeze, we have good coffee and amazing views and a great story. We walk our way down, we pack up camp, we're walking back down past amazing waterfalls, and all of a sudden, one of my buddies says something. I'm like, nah, I don't know, it's more like this. He goes, dude. I'm like, what? He's like, you disagree with everything. I'm like, no, I don't. Like, and then he lists off like 4 or 5 of the last things people had said that either I had disagreed with or I had added something to or corrected or something else. And I'm like, oh man, like, what do I do with that? Like, and so what did I do? I radically agreed with everything. He's like, oh, that's a big step. You're right, Kyle. That was the biggest step I've ever seen. I've never heard a more right statement in my life, right? Because that's what we do, and we deflect. But here's the truth, is that he and I have done enough life together. Now, true, I would love to say that he was just helping me be a better Jesus follower. I think he was just sick of me. The truth was, is he had pointed out something in me that I could not see. And for the next few miles of walk, I was thinking about, and I'll tell you, I can pinpoint the season of my life when that started and how many years since that I haven't paid any attention to that. And then I started thinking about Jesus. I'm like, Jesus isn't disagreeable. Jesus doesn't correct or add to everything. Like, is that the person I want to be? Is that the portrait I want to paint for everyone else? He saw enough of me and enough of who I wanted to be that he was able to point that out, and we were able to have conversations. Now, it was a little below the belt when he put it as a funny joke in the staff video at the Christmas party. But still, it's not something I'm winning yet, but it's something I'm attentive to because he showed me a blind spot. We need one another. Who sees you well enough? Who can you receive the truth from, even if it's getting barked at on the side of a mountain? Number two, who looks more like Jesus because of who Jesus is making you? Years ago, I came to this conviction based on what the scriptures say, that what God does in the life of the individual is always for the benefit of the community. That what he does in the life of the individual is not just for the individual, it's for the life of the community. But the only way it gets there is if we actually speak with one another and allow live life closely with one another so that we can actually see that and receive that. Then those moments when I'm not sure God's coming through, then I can sit down with people for whom God is coming through, and I can remember that God is a God who comes through. That when I'm lacking provision and God provides in someone else's life, they can remind me, hey, remember that time that God provided in your life? Oh yeah, that's right. And what's going on in my life and in the lives of others can influence me. I'm so grateful for the people that I get to watch to become more like Jesus. And I want to be the kind of person that lives closely enough with people that they can watch my life and become more like Jesus. Who's that in you? Who around you gets to do that? Question number three, this one's gonna be everybody's favorite. I can feel it already. Who requires me to give effort to not being my worst self? You're like, what does that mean? I had such a hard time wording this question. Maybe I'm the only one, but let's just try to put it this way. Are there people that they haven't even talked yet and they annoy you? Do you have people like that in your life? You know what I'm saying? You can see them from across. Don't elbow the person next to you. Don't. You can see them from 100 yards. You can like feel their presence. Like, I'm about to be annoyed, you know? They're not like you. They got habits that drive you crazy. It's just hard to get along with. FYI, you're that for somebody else, just so you know. Don't want to burst your bubble. Me too. But here's the thing. People look for groups of people who are just like them. When the truth is that when we interact with people who are different than us, those people who annoy us, you know what is really at the heart of that? It's our own junk. It's our own garbage. It's our own baggage. It's my own lack of patience. It's my own lack of grace. It's my own preferences. And Jesus says that we should consider others better than ourselves. We don't look to our own interests, but also to the interests of others. That we love our neighbor as ourselves. And how are we going to do that if we only do that with people with whom it's easy? How are we ever going to learn to love our enemies if we don't spend any time with them? And so truthfully, we need people in our lives that annoy us. And so those of us who are hunting for the perfect small group, it's not going to be found, and it's actually not best for you. and it's not best for me either. If you're looking for a church where everybody gets along and everybody's perfect and everybody's polished and everybody's just like you, you're lacking lots of things because God has put different things in every single one of us. You will never meet a person from whom you have nothing to learn, ever. So here's the thing. If you really want to live this out, apparently I was feeling direct when I wrote this, so just take this one for the team, okay? Do this. Get those people in your life now. Like, get some people in your life. Give them permission to look closely at your life. Get them around you enough that they can see there's a difference. Get people close enough to you that everything that God does in your life can benefit those people around you. And for the love, don't run away from the people who drive you crazy. They will make you more like Jesus in a way that you totally, it drives you crazy, but it's okay because you look more like him. Get those people in your life ASAP. In fact, you could start with a life group. If you are not in a life group, it's just one of the ways we do this. It's one of the ways that we try to take a disconnected city and connect people. You're not going to find the perfect one. It's not going to happen. What you need is not the perfect group. What you need is a consistent group. A group of people that you live life with and commit to living life alongside. And so here's the thing. Earlier, Jenny asked you to fill out a card. And so if you didn't do that already and you're not in a life group and God has been saying anything to you in the last 20 minutes about community, you should put your information on that card and pass it to an aisle right now. If you're not in a group, just take the card, put your information on there, pass it to the aisle, show up on the 30th. You're going to sit down with weird people. And you can look them in the eye and honestly say that you need them, okay? And step into some community if you don't have that. There's some people going to come and collect those. Any aisle will do. Pass them. If the person next to you, you don't know them, it's okay. Make awkward eye contact and tell the story later. It's okay. Just pass the card. The best time to say yes to Jesus is right now. So if God is telling you to be in community, do it right now. Don't wait till later. Don't question it. Don't wonder. Put it in the calendar. Move whatever was there. Make it a priority right now. So you can pass those at any moment. Some people are going to come collect them right now. Okay, let me shift gears. Because not only does God say, or not only is Jesus not a keep it to himself Jesus with Jesus followers, we don't keep it to ourselves with everyone else. Now, I know that culture says keep it to yourself. That's private. That's you. Keep that over there. I was a teacher for 7 years. By law, I could not speak about Jesus in front of my classroom. But you know what I could do? I could strategically pick my student aides who would come and hang out with me in my free periods. I would choose the ones who always had other people around them. And so my room would become the hangout. I would have snacks. I would have games. I would make them do work. And inevitably, they would ask me what I did with my weekend. And I would tell them. No matter where you're at, there are places to talk about Jesus. We don't keep it to ourselves. We don't care what culture says. We are not going to keep it to ourselves. Now, how we go about it matters. We'll get to that in a little bit. But we don't live this whole thing of preach the gospel. Gospel just means good news. It's the story of Jesus. We don't just preach the good news and, if necessary, use words. Because the scripture says it will require words. Yes, our actions should be in line with what we're saying, for sure. But it's going to require words. Now, I was thinking about this, and you can do this when you read through a gospel this week. Just look at how often Jesus talks about the kingdom and sends other people to talk about life with him, all right? But I thought, you know what? We've already been through Luke a little bit. Let's jump into this book of Acts. So if you have your Bible, you can grab that and just go to the book of Acts. You can just follow along with the titles of each section, and you'll get what I'm saying. But if Jesus, clearly Jesus didn't expect us to keep it to ourselves with other followers of him, but did he expect it to keep it to ourselves from everybody else? I thought, you know what? Maybe one of the best ways to do this is just look at the people who knew him and see what they did. And so we're going to pick it up in Acts chapter 1. Now, this is 40 days after Jesus has resurrected. So next week we celebrate Easter. Today's Palm Sunday. He's walking in Jerusalem. Everybody loves him. By Friday, they kill him. Sunday, he raises from the dead and invites us all into a new life. For 40 days, he appeared to over 500 people. Historical fact. He shows up in their lives, physical resurrection, and this is the last meeting he has with his followers before he goes back to be with God, before he'll return to us again. And this is what he says in verse 8. He says, you will, not you might, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses telling people about me everywhere. Jesus is like, I'm leaving. And the disciples are like, what? And so then he says, no. I'm going to give you my Holy Spirit. I'm going to live in you. I'm not going to be around you anymore. I'm going to be in you. And I'm going to give you power and strength. And the reason I'm going to give that is not so you can be strong. It's so that you can speak, so that you can be a witness. Because a witness is lousy until they open their mouths and they tell everyone everywhere. Now let's just watch what happens and see if the follower of Jesus thought they should keep it to themselves. Y'all ready? If you flip the page, I don't know, or swipe left or whatever you do with your app, Chapter 2 is when the Holy Spirit shows up, and it's a show. It is amazing. The Holy Spirit shows up in an amazing way. God sets up camp, not just around people, but in people. And look what happens in verse 14. Peter stepped forward with 11 other apostles, because we do this together. It's not a solo thing. With 11 other apostles, and shouted to the crowd, listen carefully, all of you. Preaches the gospel. People are cut to the heart. They say, what do we do? He says, turn your life toward Jesus, be baptized, and he will fill you with the Holy Spirit. And 3,000 people that day start following him. And then you know what those 3,000 people did? They did not go live by themselves. Read the end of chapter 2, because we do this thing together. Chapter 3, we find Peter and John walking along, and there's this person who can't walk. And the person's like, hey, give me some money. And Peter's like, no, but you can walk. And so he says, by the name of Jesus, stand up and walk. Dude stands up and walks. And people are like, what? And so Peter starts telling this story about Jesus and how all of this has to do with how strong Jesus is and the power of the name of Jesus. Well, the problem is that all the people who killed Jesus didn't like that. So they grab Peter and John and they bring him in and they say, shut up. They say, stop talking. Don't talk about Jesus. And Peter says this to those guys. Verse 20, we cannot stop telling about everything we have seen and heard. Are these a keep it to yourself people? I don't think so. They go back to their group of believers because we don't do this by ourselves. And they decide to start praying. And you know what they prayed for? For all the suffering to stop. Nope. What they decide to pray for is in chapter 4, verse 29. He says, they're all praying together and say this. And now, O Lord, hear their threats and give us, your servants, great boldness in preaching the word. They didn't say stop the attacks. They said give us more strength. And so the Holy Spirit does. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and they preached the word of God with boldness. Chapter 5. In chapter 5, we find Peter and John walking around healing more people in the name of Jesus. People say, what's going on? They start talking about Jesus. People who killed Jesus arrest Peter and John, throw them into prison for the night. In the middle of the night, God busts them out of prison and says, hey, go hide in a hole. Things are getting a little shady. Nope. He says, I want you to go right back to the temple and tell people what's going on about Jesus. So at daybreak, verse 21, the apostles entered the temple as they were told and immediately began teaching. Guys arrest them again. Duh, you're in the same spot. They get arrested again. And they say, stop speaking. This time they flog them and tear their backs open with stones and bone and leather straps. They flog them and the disciples leave. In verse 41, the apostles left the high council rejoicing that God had counted them worthy to suffer disgrace for the name of Jesus. And every day they continued to teach and preach the message that Jesus is the Messiah. Chapter 6. In chapter 6, we see that they're getting busy with all these tasks because people started following Jesus. There's like 5,000 of them at this point. And they're like, hey, people need taken care of. So they say, hey, you 7 guys full of the Spirit, you take care of people. We're going to pray and do the ministry of the word. You know what the ministry of the word is? Preaching, which they did together. And so they start preaching even more. But one of the 7 guys didn't get the message. His name was Stephen. And he starts speaking about Jesus because he can't keep his mouth closed because he's not a keep it to yourself person. He starts speaking and speaking and speaking. He gets up and gives this big speech. And people get so ticked that they throw him off the side of a cliff and throw rocks on him till he's dead. He got stoned. Not like stoned, but like stoned. Dead. Because he was speaking. If Jesus expected them to keep it to themselves, they didn't get the message. No one who knew Jesus thought they should keep it to themselves. You couldn't stop them. Some of my favorite scriptures in Acts chapter 8 of the whole book. I'm not even a third of the way through the book. We could go for days. But in Acts chapter 8, we get a little glimpse into the situation. Acts chapter 8, verse 1, it says this. A great wave of persecution began that day, the day that Stephen got killed, sweeping over all the church. And church just means all the groups of believers, of followers of Jesus in Jerusalem. And all the believers, except the apostles, were scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria. Verse 3, but Saul was going everywhere to destroy the church. He went from house to house, dragging out both men and women to throw them into prison. So all the believers, except the apostles, are run out of town. They're run out of their homes, away from their communities. They're sent everywhere. And then there's even a guy who's going house to house to try to hunt them down and throw them in prison, men and women. And you know what they did? Verse 4. But the believers who were scattered preached the good news about Jesus wherever they went. I love that because that should be a picture of how we leave this building in a few minutes. They preached the good news wherever they went. You see, the truth is that speaking about Jesus is not what pastors do. It's not what apostles do. Speaking about Jesus is not what missionaries do. Speaking about Jesus is what Christians do. It is at the core of who we are that we bear witness and we speak in every way and every opportunity that we can to call people to life in Jesus. Because that's what people did for us. To the very cost of their lives, we wouldn't be sitting here if those people didn't refuse to stop speaking. Now, some of you are like, I don't want a microphone and I don't want a stage. It's not what I'm saying about preaching. The Greek word for preaching literally just means it takes the noun, gospel, or good news, and turns it into a verb. You're just supposed to go good news people. Go good newsing. Just get people straight up good newsed. You know what I'm saying? That's what it means. It's like this time on Thanksgiving 3 years ago. You know, when they were doing all the sales started on Thanksgiving instead of Black Friday. And so me and three guys decided to go to Walmart on Thanksgiving. I know there's lots of things wrong with that story. We can talk about it later. We show up, and it's like one of those little games that's got squares in it, and only one of them's missing, and you got to move everything else to try to move one of the squares into that space. It was like that, but with like 2,000 people in Walmart. And in the aisles, we're just weaving back and forth just for the iPad line that we were in to try to get some steal on iPads. We were there for like 2 hours. Line hadn't even moved. We knew the people behind us, in front of us, the people in front of them and behind them. We've messed with everything on all the shelves. I felt so bad for whoever had to sort that out later. We're there for like 2 hours, and all of a sudden, this lady from the group behind us, she disappears for a little bit, like, she probably went to the restroom, whatever. She comes back, and she's like whispering with the people that she was in a group with. And then they start to leave, and I'm like, hey, where are you going? And she goes, they're moving the line, but they haven't told anybody yet. I'm like, really? Where are they moving it? And she goes, back here, come with us. And so we're like, okay. Like we're out of here. And so we disappear and we get to layaway or the back area at customer service. We're number 3 in line. Like, yeah. Some of you are like high justice people are like, you're a cheater. You cut to the front of the line without paying the price of the line. That's a scandal. So's the gospel, people. Like you get straight to the front of the line that whatever it is that we has kept us from God, we skip the line. All they did was say, hey, we found out something, and you should come with us. That's what preaching is. Hey, your marriage doesn't have to be a train wreck. Hey, you don't have to live life in Las Vegas alone. Hey, just so you know, that thing you're punishing yourself for, Jesus was already punished for that. You're good. Let's move on. Hey, that addiction you are sure you can't get over, just so you know, that's not true. I know a place you can get help. All we do is go everywhere with anything that we have experienced. The people behind us in line just took what they found out and told us. What do you think we should do? We just take what we find out about Jesus. We tell people around us. Speaking about Jesus is what Christians do. Now, there's some ways we should probably do this in our culture, and I'll warn you that the next little bit on your outline, even though there's official blanks on your outline, it's just my opinion. This is not the scripture speaking, so you can take this or leave it if you want. But from a guy who cares a lot about talking to people about Jesus, this may help you. Here's a few guidelines to consider if you're really going to start speaking out in the way that God has called us to speak out. Number one, personal is way better than broadcast. You can throw stuff on Facebook all day long, but all you got to do is scroll through to see all the other white noise that's there. Personal. a person that you care about, someone that you look in the face, whose life you're involved in, that you care about, that you get to know, that you speak in a way that makes sense to them, is always going to be way more helpful than trying to throw stuff out to the masses, said the guy with the microphone. Personal is way better than broadcast. Descriptive beats prescriptive every day of the week and twice on Sunday. That if we will just describe what God has said and how that has changed our lives, that will go miles farther than ever looking in someone's eye and say, you should do this. We need to stop waving fingers and thumping Bibles and just start telling the truth about what God is doing in our lives and helping people know that there's space around Jesus for them. People don't need to be told what to do. They need to be told what God is willing to do in your life and is willing to do in theirs, if they'll be invited in. And number three, invitation eats condemnation for breakfast. Jesus wasn't, I can point this to the scripture anytime you want. Invitation beats condemnation by miles. People don't need to be made feel small. People don't need to be judged. They need to be invited to more. Jesus wasn't here to judge and condemn. In fact, it explicitly says that in John chapter 3. He says, God did not send Jesus into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. People already have messes all around them. They don't need us to show up and point them out. What they need is for us to paint a picture and cast a vision and invite them into it. And say, your life could be like this with Jesus. Come with me. Just come with me. Let's just check it out. Just see if it's not true. Invitation is always better than condemnation. Now, if you really want to live this thing out, I would encourage you to do a few things. Number one, pray daily for strength to speak boldly about Jesus. Every day in the morning, ask for every opportunity you can to speak boldly for Jesus. Just open Acts chapter 4, pray with them. They prayed for boldness. Number two, at the end of each day, or number two, look for natural places to talk about Jesus in your conversation. Notice we said natural. Don't be weird. Okay? Can we just all like raise our right hand and commit to not being weird? Now, some of you are naturally weird. So for you to try to be natural would be weird. Don't do that. Be you. And in conversation, just talk about Jesus. If Jesus is at the center of our life, how could we not talk about him? How could you talk about my life in any particular way if Jesus is at the center and never hear about Jesus? That's crazy talk. That doesn't make any sense at all. And so we just talk about it naturally. It's not like somebody calls you up and says, hey, you going to the gym today? Nope, doing Bible study. How about you? Don't be weird. Like I was talking about with teaching. Hey, what'd you do this weekend? Man, I hang out with these people. I had a phenomenal conversation in the Palm Grove at my church. Man, we've been going through this thing. It's been so good. And leave room for questions. Don't preach your heart out. Just invite people in. What's going on in your world? It's been a struggle at home, but man, I've been teaching my kids this because God has told us this, and this has been so good. They're like actually getting it. It's actually making a difference in their lives. Really. Just be natural. It doesn't have to be crazy. Number three, reflect each day, asking God to help you see opportunities that you both took and missed, and share your stories with your life group or the people that you follow Jesus with. Reflect every single day. God, did I take any opportunities? God, did I miss any opportunities? God, help me take them all tomorrow. There's no condemnation with him. There's no judgment. He's not frustrated. You think God won't lead you into that? He says, pray anything in line with my will, and I'll give it to you. I guarantee that prayer is in line with his will. And number four, just say, come with me. Invite people to places that matter to you. We're going to have a blast on Saturday doing this family thing. There's going to be little kids riding motorized animals around. What's not to like? Just invite people. They got kids, invite them along. The kids will have a blast. You can have a great conversation. Just say, come with me. Invite people to Easter service. Say, what plans do you have? Millions of people are willing to go to church on Easter when they're not willing to go any other time. And if they know you and you matter to them and church matters to you, on some level, church matters to them. Just say, come with me. What do you have to lose? People who follow Jesus speak consistently about him. We are not a keep it to ourselves people. And let's be honest, I get that all this is risky. I get it. If you're going to let people into your world and not keep it to yourself with other believers, that's some risk. Because people do dumb stuff, and they might do dumb stuff to you. I get it. It's risky. And I get it. If you start speaking about Jesus everywhere you go, just like the early followers of Jesus did, Some people aren't going to react well to that. But can I just tell you how grateful I am for the people in my life who did not keep it to themselves? And for the people who I live life with Jesus with right now, who even frustrated on the side of a mountain will not keep it to themselves. Because I live a life alive in Jesus because of those people. And every day I come more and more alive, and God rescues me more and more and more as I allow believers to speak into my life. We should never, ever be a keep it to ourselves people. Because Jesus is not a keep it to yourself Jesus. Would you stand and pray with me? And so God, thank you so much that you didn't keep it to yourself, that Jesus showed up and entered our mess and rescued us and invites us out of it and invites us to be change agents in it. And so God, I pray for boldness for every single believer here, that they would connect with other believers. For every person who's not even sure about you, to just be willing to spend time around other believers, that we would connect and allow people to see our lives and us see their lives and us encourage and follow you together. And I pray for every single one of us, regardless of where we're at in our journey, that we would take anything and everything that we know and experience about you and speak it boldly in ways that invite people who are lost and broken and searching, that we love and care about, and the city that we love and care about, that they would come alive in you. And so, God, we could never do that on our own, and we wouldn't even want to. And so thank you for your Holy Spirit who gives us strength. God, thank you for Jesus who went first and paid the price for us. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Have a great week. See you at Easter.